This is the last part of deposit from Article 1992 to Article 2009 of the new Civil Code. Obligations of the depositor. Article 1992. If the deposit is gratuitous, the depositor is obliged to reimburse the depositary for the expenses he may have incurred for the preservation of the thing deposited. So here we make a distinction between a deposit which is gratuitous and one which is for compensation. Kasi dito sa 1992, gratuitous deposit ito. If the deposit is gratuitous, then the depositor has to reimburse the depositary for unnecessary expenses he may have incurred on the thing deposited. Bakit necessary? Kasi nakalagay dito, expenses he may have incurred for the preservation of the thing. So these are necessary expenses. Whereas if the deposit is for compensation, there is no need to reimburse because usually yung payment for the deposit already includes the projected expenses for the preservation of the thing deposited. For example, ang deposit ay dog, aso, no? Dineposit mo yan sa kaibigan mo dahil mag-a-abroad ka for 6 months, kailangan may mag-alaga sa aso, so idineposit mo yung aso sa isang kaibigan, and it is gratuitous, kumukaibigan mo siya. Then pagbalik mo, pag i-claim mo na, assuming you are the depositor, ay babayaran mo yung mga necessary expenses na nagastos niya dun sa aso. For example, yung pagkain, yung gastos niya sa toiletries like shampoo and soap, kung ibinili niya ng toys para hindi ma-depress yung aso, para may laruan, then kasama yon sa expenses na babayaran ng depositary. Pero kung nagpabayad si friend, binayaran mo siya para mag-alaga ng aso mo in the meantime, then hindi ka mag-reimburse kasi usually yung bayad sa kanya ay kasama na doon yung expenses, yung projected expenses niya sa aso. Alam niya na kung more or less magkasong gagastusin niya sa pagkain, sa toiletry, etc. Ikakarga niya na doon yung isasama niya na yun sa pagkwenta niya kung magkano sisingilin sa depositor. So, the rule is if it's gratuitous, the depositor is obliged to reimburse the depositary for necessary expenses, but if it is onerous or for compensation, there is no need. Kasi yung fee na ibabayad kay depositary ay kasama na doon yung projected expenses on the thing deposited. Article 1993. The depositor shall reimburse the depositary for any loss arising from the character of the thing deposited, unless at the time of the constitution of the deposit, the former was not aware of or was not expected to know the dangerous character of the thing, or unless he notified the depositary of the same, or the latter was aware of it without advice from the depositor. So, isang sentence lang to, but there is a general rule and there are 4 exceptions. So, halimbawa, there is A, the depositor, B is the depositary. A deposits would be, for example, 100 drums of chemical. A is an ordinary businessman. He is a middleman. He imported these things from China and he is selling this to a client in Mindanao. In the meantime, habang hindi pa pinipick up ng kliyente niya from Mindanao, diniposit niya muna sa warehouse. Okay, so hindi niya alam, halimbawa hindi niya alam na itong chemicals na to, pag nainitan or halimbawa, umakyat sa 40 degrees Celsius ang temperatura, ito'y sumasabog. Halimbawa, no? So, diniposit niya to kay ABC Warehouse, kay depositary. Then, halimbawa, nasira yung aircon, mainit sa paligid, umabot sa 40 degrees centigrade, sumabog yung 100 drums of chemicals. So, nasira yung mga iba pang nakadeposito sa warehouse, nasira yung isang section ng warehouse. What is the rule? The rule is the depositor shall reimburse the depositor for any loss arising from the character of the thing deposited. Yun ang general rule. Yung depositor dapat bayaran niya kung ano man yung perwisyo, kung ano man yung nasira dahil sa karakter ng kanyang dineposito. General rule. But there are four exceptions wherein the depositor need not or is not obliged to pay. Number one, if at the time of the constitution of the deposit, the former, which is the depositor, was not aware of the dangerous character of the thing. Yan ang unang exception. If the depositor, at the time of the constitution of the deposit, was not aware of the dangerous character of the thing. So, si A, kung ordinaryong businessman lang naman siya, this is the first time na nag-import siya ng ganong klaseng chemical kasi may nag-order sa kanya, ay hindi niya alam na yung pala ay pag 40 degrees centigrade ang paligid, yun sumasabog. So in which case, kung hindi niya alam dahil siya ay ordinary businessman lang, hindi naman siya chemist, hindi man siya physicist or whatever, so hindi siya obliged na magbayad because at the time of the constitution of the deposit, he was not aware of the dangerous character of the thing. Number two exception, at the time of the constitution of the deposit, he was not expected to know the dangerous character of the thing. Yung una, he was not aware. Yung pangalawa, he was not expected to know. Kasi ordinary businessman siya, hindi naman siya chemist, wala siyang experience or previous experience pertaining to the same material. So, he was not expected to know. Walang negligence sa kanya. Hindi niya lang alam or hindi lang siya inaasahang makaalam tungkol doon. Number three exception is, unless he notified the depositary of the same, assuming na alam niya, ay sinabihan niya naman yung depositary. Sabi niya, Mr. Depositary, ito pa, ingatan mo to kasi pag umabot sa pag umakyat sa 40 degrees centigrade ang temperatura, ito ay sumasabog. So yung air conditioning mo ayusin mo diyan sa warehouse. Sinabihan niya and then sumabog. Then hindi siya pwedeng sisihin, hindi siya obligado magbayad kasi wala siyang negligence. Sinabihan niya yung warehouse man or the depositary tungkol doon sa risk. And number four exception, the latter was aware of it without advice from the depositor. So, yung warehouse man or yung depositary, siguro may experience na siya tungkol sa ganong klaseng chemical na kahit hindi siya sinabihan ni depositor, ay alam niya na ang ganong klaseng material, ang ganong klaseng chemical, ay sumasabog pag umaabot sa 40 degrees centigrade. So 1993 gives us a general rule that depositor shall reimburse the depositary for any loss arising from the character of the thing deposited. General rule. Exceptions, number one, if at the time of the constitution of the deposit, the depositor was not aware of the dangerous character of the thing. Number two exception, if at the time of the constitution of the deposit, the depositor was not expected to know the dangerous character of the thing. Number three exception, if he notified the depositary of the same. Ibig sabihin, alam ni depositor at sinabi niya kay depositary yung risk. And number four, kahit hindi niya alam, kahit hindi niya sinabi, but the depositary was aware of it without advice from the depositor, then under these four exceptions, the depositor is not obliged to reimburse the depositary for any loss arising from the character of the thing deposited. Article 1994. The depositary may retain the thing in pledge until the full payment of what may be due him by reason of the deposit. So it is clear here na yung depositary pwede niyang i-retain or pwedeng hindi niya muna ibalik yung bagay na nakadeposit sa kanya hanggang hindi pa bayad si depositor sa kanya. Bakit naman may utang sa kanya sa depositor? Halimbawa, dito sa Article 1992, where the deposit is gratuitous, the depositor is obliged to reimburse the depositary for the necessary expenses that the depositary may have incurred by reason of the deposit sa 1992. Dito naman sa 1993, ito yung sabi dito, the depositor shall reimburse the depositary for any loss arising from the character of the thing deposited with four exceptions. So, halimbawa, si depositor may utang kay depositary because of 1992 or 1993, then justified si depositary na hindi niya muna ibalik. Magiging parang sangla. You know, he can hold the thing in pledge until the full payment of what may be due him by reason of the deposit. So, hanggang hindi nagbabayad si depositor sa kanya, in full, may karapatan siyang i-hold muna yung bagay na dineposit sa kanya, huwag niya munang i-release hanggang hindi pa fully paid si depositor. Article 1995, a deposit is extinguished 1. Upon the loss or destruction of the thing deposited, 2. In case of a gratuitous deposit, upon the death of either the depositor or the depositary. Well, actually, there are several ways of extinguishing a contract of deposit. Please refer to Article 1231, which is also found in this slide. Yung number 1, loss of the thing, is included in 1231. So, let's go to number 2. In case of gratuitous, upon the death of either the depositor or the depositary. So, take note, this happens only where the contract of deposit is gratuitous. Kasi kung siya ay with compensation, death of either one of them does not extinguish the contract. The rights of the depositor or the depositary are transmitted to the heirs. But of course, the heirs are free to decide whether to terminate or not even before the expiration of the period. So, may I repeat? If gratuitous, the death of either one of the parties extinguishes, but if for compensation, the rights of the parties are transmitted to the heirs. But the heirs, of course, are free to decide whether to terminate or not even before the expiration of the period of the contract. Necessary deposit, Article 1996. A deposit is necessary, 1. When it is made in compliance with a legal obligation, 2. When it takes place on the occasion of any calamity, such as fire, storm, flood, pillage, shipwreck, or other similar events. Ano yung example ng number 1? The judicial deposit of a thing, the possession of which is being disputed in a litigation by two or more persons, is an example of a judicial deposit in number 1. It is made in compliance with the legal obligation. Sa number 2, ang example dito, yung tinatawag natin, involuntary deposit. We have discussed this before. Sabi natin, there are 3 situations where deposit is for compensation. Number 1, when there is a stipulation. Number 2, where the depositary is engaged in the business of storing goods. And number 3, ito yun, in case of involuntary deposit. Ano yung example natin? Somebody, A, has a car, he deposits the car or he parks the car in a parking lot of a mall, for example, and then fire breaks out, for example, nalagay sa peligro yung kanyang kotse, hindi niya alam na nasa peligro ang kanyang kotse. B, keeps the car, saves it from destruction, keeps it in the meantime. So, pagdating ng panahon na babawiin na ni A yung kotse kay B, kasi iniligtas ni B yung kanyang kotse from destruction, then A, the owner, must compensate B for the efforts of saving the car and keeping it in the meantime. Yun ang example ng necessary deposit. Ang tawag natin doon ay involuntary deposit. Bakit involuntary? Kasi hindi niya naman kusang loob na ipinatago kay B. Actually, hindi niya alam na nasa peligro ang kotse niya. Pero si B, nagkusang loob niyang iniligtas sa peligro yung kotse. Itinago niya muna. inalagaan niya, and then pagdating ng panahon na babawiin na ni A ng mga ari, dapat magbayan si A. So ito'y naging deposit for compensation. This is the second type of necessary deposit here in 1996. Article 1997, the deposit referred to in number 1 of the preceding article shall be governed by the provisions of the law establishing it, and in case of its deficiency, by the rules on voluntary deposit. The deposit mentioned in number 2 of the preceding article shall be regulated by the provisions concerning voluntary deposit and by Article 2168, which I also place here for reference. Article 1998, the deposit of effects made by travelers in hotels or inns shall also be regarded as necessary. The keepers of hotels or inns shall be responsible for them as depositaries, provided that notice was given to them or to their employees of the effects brought by the guests, and that, on the part of the latter, they take the precautions which said hotel keepers or their substitutes advised relative to the care and vigilance of their effects. So the question is, are hotel and innkeepers responsible for the loss of the personal effects brought in by travelers and guests? So there are two requirements for them to be responsible as depositaries. Number one, that the travelers or guests must inform them of the fact that they are bringing in some personal effects, and number two, that they comply with the advice given by this hotel and innkeepers as to the precautions to be taken relative to their personal effects. Kung present ang dalawang conditions na yan at nawala yung personal effect, then responsible or liable yung hotel keepers or innkeepers because they are regarded as depositaries. So, example, A guest checks into the hotel bringing in some jewelry and cash. So, anong dapat gawin ni guest? Dapat sasabihin niya doon sa hotel keeper, innkeeper, or sa empleyado ng hotel or inn. Sasabihin niya na ito, dala-dala ko itong this amount of money and this specific jewelry. Sasabihin niya, i-report niya. And then, sasabihin naman, halimbawa, sabihin naman ng empleyado ng inn or ng hotel, ma'am, ilagay po natin sa safety deposit. Meron kami dito sa hotel na safety deposit. Sumunod naman yung guest, inilagay niya sa safety deposit ng hotel. Pag yun nawala, liable yung hotel. Kasi, number one, nireport niya. Number two, sinunod niya yung precaution na in-advise ng hotel. Pero halimbawa, sinabi niya lang, mayroon ako ditong cash, 1 million, mayroon ako ditong ganito mga jewelry. Sabi ng hotel representative or hotel employee, ilagay po natin sa vault. Pero hindi niya sinunod. The following day, nawala. Hindi liable si inn or hotel keeper. Dahil hindi niya sinunod yung advice as to what precaution to take. Therefore, this is the rule. Para maging liable yung hotel keeper or innkeeper, where there is a loss of personal effects brought in by travelers or guests, the following must concur. Number one, the guest or the traveler must inform the hotel keeper or the innkeeper of the fact that he is carrying some personal effects, for example, money, jewelry, documents, etc. And number two, sundin niya yung precaution na sasabihin sa kanya ng innkeeper, hotel keeper, or their substitutes, their employees. Sasabihin, ilagay po natin siya sa vault ng hotel, ilagay natin dito sa ganitong klaseng lalagyan. At pag sinunod niya yun, yung precaution na sinabi ng guest, at nawala pa rin, then liable si hotel keeper or innkeeper as depositary. Pero kung hindi nag-concur yung dalawang requirements na yun, hindi niya na-report na may dala siyang cash, and then the following day habang nagbe-breakfast siya, ay nawala. Hindi liable si hotel keeper. O kaya in-report niya naman, pero hindi niya sinunod yung advice na ilagay natin sa vault, hindi niya sinunod. Therefore, liable, personally liable siya sa pagkawala ng gamit niya, walang liability si innkeeper or hotel keeper. Article 1999. The hotel keeper is liable for the vehicles, animals, and articles which have been introduced or placed in the annexes of the hotel. So, bakit may animals? Kasi nung unang panahon, pwede kang mag-check-in ang nakasakay ka sa karitela, sa kabayo, sa kalabaw, etc. So, ganun din ang rule. You have to report the fact that you are bringing in with you some vehicles, animals, articles, and you have to abide by the advice of the hotel employee as to where to place them. So, dito po natin ilagay ang animal, dito natin ilagay ang iyong karitela, etc. So, pag nag-concur yung dalawang yun, you report and then you follow the advice. Then, pag nawala sila, liable si innkeeper or hotel keeper as depositary. So, karugtong ito ng 1998. Article 2000. The responsibility referred to in the two preceding articles shall include the loss of or injury to the personal property of the guests caused by the servants or employees of the keepers of hotels or inns, as well as strangers, but not that which may proceed from any force majeure. The fact that travelers are constrained to rely on the vigilance of the keeper of the hotels or inns shall be considered in determining the degree of care required of them. So, for as long as the requirements in 1998 and 1999 are complied with, ano yun? That the guests or traveler must report the fact that they are bringing in some personal effects or animals or vehicles or articles, and that they follow the advice of the hotel or innkeepers or their employees as to the precautions to take in order to prevent a loss. Then, in case of a loss or damage to these personal effects, the hotel and innkeepers are liable as depositary. Yun ang sinasabi dito. Regardless of whether the cause of the loss or damage maybe the servants or employees themselves of the hotel or inns or strangers, regardless kung sino yung dahilan, halimbawa nawala or nasira at ang dahilan ay yung empleyado mismo or kaya strangers or fellow guests, doesn't matter. If the requirements in 1998 and 1999 are complied with, then the hotel keeper and the innkeeper are liable for such loss. Pero nakalagay dito, not that which may proceed from any force majeure. If the loss or damage is by reason of force majeure, then the innkeeper, the hotel keeper, are not liable. Ano yung force majeure? Ito yung tinatawag nating acts of God and acts of man. Acts of God kasama na yung fortuitous event. Events that cannot be foreseen, though foreseen are inevitable. Ito namang acts of man, ito yung like war and riot. These are things that are beyond our control. So, if the loss or damage is by reason of force majeure, then the innkeeper, the hotel keeper, is not liable for such loss or damage. Article 2001. The act of a thief or robber who has entered the hotel is not deemed force majeure unless it is done with the use of arms or through an irresistible force. So, assuming of course that the requirements under 1998 and 1999 are complied with, where the personal effects of guests or travelers are lost due to a thief or robber, the innkeeper or the hotel keeper is liable as depositary. That is a general rule. However, if the thief or robber perpetrated the crime with the use of arms or exerted violence upon the guest in order to take the personal property from them, then the hotel keeper and the innkeeper is not liable because these are not considered as force majeure. Article 2002. The hotel keeper is not liable for compensation if the loss is due to the acts of the guest, his family, servants, or visitors, or if the loss arises from the character of the things brought into the hotel. So this article gives us two situations where the hotel keeper or innkeeper is not liable for the loss of things brought in by guests or travelers. Number one, where the loss is due to the acts of the guest himself, his family, servants, or visitors. Sila mismo yung nakasira sa gamit nila or nakawala sa gamit nila. So despite the fact that they had reported them to the hotel keeper or innkeeper and they followed the advice as to precautions to take, if the guest himself, his family, servants, or visitors caused the loss or damage to their things, then the hotel keeper or innkeeper is not liable. Number two situation where the hotel keeper or innkeeper is not liable is if the loss arises from the character and the things brought into the hotel. Halimbawa, nagdala sila ng perishable. Kahit na nireport nila yon, kahit na inilagay nila yon sa dapat paglagyan, kung ang pagkawala naman, pagkasira, ay dahil sa karakter ng bagay na dinala nila. Perishable yung dala nila. Halimbawa, vegetables, food stuff, etc. Then, the hotel keeper or innkeeper would not be liable for the loss or damage to the thing. Article 2003. The hotel keeper cannot free himself from responsibility by posting notices to the effect that he is not liable for the articles brought by the guest. Any stipulation between the hotel keeper and the guest whereby the responsibility of the former as set forth in Articles 1998 and 2001 is suppressed or diminished shall be void. Ano yung Articles 1998 to 2001? Ito yung mga articles na nagsasabi na yung hotel keeper and keeper are liable as depositary for the loss or damage to things brought in by the guest or traveler. So, halimbawa, pagpasok natin sa hotel, may nakapaskil na kratula. Sabi sa kratula eh, this hotel shall not be liable for the damage or loss to your property, so please take care of them. Or halimbawa naman, nung nag-check-in tayo, may pinirmahan tayo na may nakalagay sa likod na stating basically the same thing, that the hotel shall not be liable for loss or damage to our personal effects. These are not valid waiver because it is axiomatic that the law is deemed written into every contract. Therefore, under 1306 also, any stipulation that is contrary to law is void. So these are not valid waivers. So if there is a conflict between an agreement, kahit na pinirmahan mo yon, an agreement and the law always prevails. Therefore, itong kratulang ito, itong pinirmahan natin ito, these are not valid waivers because of 1998 to 2001, whereby the law states the situations where the innkeeper or the hotel keeper are liable as depositary. Article 2004. The hotel keeper has a right to retain the things brought into the hotel by the guest as a security for credits on account of lodging and supplies usually furnished to hotel guests. So, pag nag-check-in tayo sa hotel or sa inn, may mga supply ka agad. May towel dyan, may pagkain sa ref, etc. Then, after the stay of the guest, he fails to pay his bill. Ano ang karapatan naman ng hotel keeper? Sabi sa 2004, the hotel keeper can retain the things brought into the hotel by the guest. Kumbaga parang naging pledge. Hanggang hindi mo binabayaran yung billing, ay hindi rin namin i-release itong gamit mo. Ito yung supplies usually furnished to hotel guests. What about the food? Every morning, lunch, dinner, kumakain si guest doon. Ang free lang naman usually yung breakfast. Pero yung lunch at dinner, eh, may bayad yun. Nandadala pa siya ng mga kaibigan. Anong remedyo ng hotel keeper? Siguro kasuhan niya ng estafa yung guest on top of his right to retain the things brought in. Parang naging ano siya, naging pledge siya. Naging pledge. Hanggang hindi nagbabayad, may karapatan si hotel keeper or innkeeper to retain the things. Sequestration or judicial deposit. Article 2005. A judicial deposit or sequestration takes place when an attachment or seizure of property in litigation is ordered. So this is the definition of a judicial deposit or sequestration. May court order siya for the attachment or seizure of property in litigation. Article 2006, movable as well as immovable property may be the object of sequestration. So we already discussed this under Article 1966, which says that only movable things may be the object of deposit. So, pag extrajudicial, movable lang. Pero pag judicial, it can be movable or immovable. Article 2007, the depositary of property or objects sequestered cannot be relieved of his responsibility until the controversy which gave rise thereto has come to an end unless the court so orders. So a judicial deposit is ordered in relation to a pending case in order to keep the status quo. So the court appoints usually a disinterested person to be a depositary to these things that are seized by the court. And this person who serves as the depositary cannot relieve himself of responsibility until the finality of the case, according to 2007, until the case comes to an end or unless the court orders an earlier termination of his duty as a depositary. Article 2008. The depositary of property sequestered is bound to comply with respect to the same with all the obligations of a good father of a family. So, the depositary of a judicial deposit has all the duties and obligations of a regular depositary. And he is expected to exercise due diligence in the care of the things under deposit. Due diligence being diligence of a good father of a family. Article 2009, as to matters not provided for in this code, judicial sequestration shall be governed by the rules of court. End of deposit. Thank you.